Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. I'm Al. I'm joined by Father James from the Barely Protestant Channel. We have a treat for you today. We're not going to be talking about apologetics, you know, about the early church, about the church today, about Catholic or Anglican. Not today. Plenty of that in the future, but not today. Today is a special treat. We're going to do some book reviews. 2 years ago, not quite 2 years ago, but in January of 2021, if you recall, Father James and I did a live stream on bad apologetics, and we got off topic talking about Star Wars books because Father James used it in an analogy. However, and then after that, we did top 10 Star Wars books. Now, in the top 10 books, there was two books in particular. One's called Heir to the Empire. The other one is called Darth, Plagueis, and they're both here. And as you know, Heir to the Empire is actually the first book in a trilogy. For some reason, I ordered online, and the second book came in this larger thing, so it looks odd on the bookshelf. Oh well, not a biggie.
I don't buy any that have the Legends moniker in it. Because it's part of my protest against Disney. So,
yeah. that's admirable. So a question then: if you're going to purchase an old book that's currently classified as Legends, how do you do that? Do you try to?
Find I buy them used. Yeah.
Or the Kindle.
To find them used. Yeah. I generally try to find them used. If it gets to the, I've got a lot of the Star Wars books. So if it ever gets to the point, where I just can't find any more that don't have the Legends moniker, I'll just bite the bullet and do it. But
yeah, avoid it at all costs, though.
Exactly. Yeah.
Father James, you don't mind giving a brief explanation to our viewers the difference between the Disney canon and Legends?
Yeah, sure. So the when Disney acquired Lucasfilm and thus Star Wars and all that, what they ended up doing was essentially sort of deleting everything that happens in the what's called the expanded universe. I guess maybe I should start off with that. So, you know, when the first movie comes out, the original Star Wars, A New Hope, soon after, people start making books and sort of putting it within the storyline of Star Wars. The first one, I think, is actually Splinter of the Mind's Eye, which is, it's okay. It's not amazing. But especially starting in the 90s, the early 90s with Heir to the Empire, which is one of the ones that we'll be talking about soon. There's this like expansion of Star Wars that goes beyond just the movies, at that point, the trilogy. Yeah. And it goes into just creating the world just much, much further. And actually, this is what got me into Star Wars. When I was a child in the 90s, I fell in love with Star Wars by reading the books, and I hadn't even watched the movies yet. So for me, the books and you know, the video games and other stuff like that, they're what's known as, in comics as well, they're what's known as the expanded universe, everything that goes beyond the movies, the officially sanctioned movies and such. So it soon ends up going from like thousands of years and tens of thousands of years before the movies to hundreds of years after the movies. And it just becomes this amazing world that characters just from all over the galaxy you learn about and everything, and stories and all that, and you know, entire empires and races and everything. That all gets basically deleted when Disney takes over in 2012. And so when I found out about Disney taking over, I was interested at first, but then my biggest fear was, oh, are they going to get rid of the expanded universe, these books and these video games and all sort of stuff? And they tried to act like they weren't getting rid of it. They just sort of are relegating it as a separate canon. But for me, that, like, especially if you're not continuing it, like, it's not, it's being deleted, you know? And it got to the point where, like, there were some good projects that were coming out that we were really excited about. One of the ones was a Star Wars project. I think it was deleted or stopped because of the Disney acquisition, but it was called 1313 or something like that. And it was a video game that was supposed to be sort of a story of Boba Fett as a bounty hunter. And you're playing as Boba Fett, but like without the full Mandalorian gear and stuff like that. So I was really excited about that. So many of us were, but then it got canceled and, you know, so anyway, the point being that Legends is what the expanded universe was before Disney. And then when Disney came out and with their stuff, that is a separate canon. So there's no Rey Skywalker. There's no, you know, First Order. There's no blue-haired admirals who, you know, what I can't remember the admiral, whoever, you know, none of that stuff. It's just an entirely separate storyline that, you know, Luke gets married. Spoiler alert, I won't say who. You know, Luke gets married. He has he has one child. The Solo Han and Leia get married. They have three children. It goes into all sorts of different directions from the Disney canon, and it's much better. It's just by far so much better.
Yeah. And now a thing that's interesting, like we're going to talk about, as soon as we're done, I'm going to go over some books that I could be reading next. This is Darth Bane. This is about 1,000 years before the Battle of Yavin. And they've got a couple, like I've got the book for Revan here. That's about 4,000 years prior to the Battle of Yavin. And they've got a single book called The Dawn of the Jedi, which is like 25,000.
Oh, that's I haven't read that one yet, but I do have it. I haven't read it yet.
Yeah, so like that's interesting. But a thing is, if you go into the Disney canon, they don't have anything further back than about 380 before Battle of Yavin. So like, yeah. I just found that interesting. You know, it's not good or bad because I don't really read that canon. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so that's interesting. They're focusing on certain areas that were not emphasized in the, because I don't think there's a lot between, like in Legends canon, I don't think there's a lot between Darth Bane and Plagueis. There may be one or two, but I don't think there's a lot.
I think there's a lot of comic stuff, I think. But, Bane, I think, actually, yeah, essentially there's not anything that I can think of that's major, at least, definitely, between those two books, or between that series, the Bane trilogy and Plagueis.
Okay. All right. So let's talk about Heir to the Empire and part of a trilogy, and I'll let you just start off.
Yeah, so this is the book that is the one that revitalized like this great love for Star Wars in the early 90s. I think the book came out in 1991, and it's until Disney took over in 2012, it became it was considered like the sequel trilogy. These three books, Heir to the Empire, Dark Force Rising, and The Last Command. The Last Command, right? I think, yeah. This book takes place about 5 years or so after the end of Return of the Jedi.
Yep.
And it's dealing with all the, you know, central and main characters, but it adds a lot of very interesting characters. In fact, two of my favorite characters in all of Star Wars are from this book series. We're started in Heir to the Empire, and that would be Grand Admiral Thrawn and Mara Jade, those two. But they have a few other good ones, like who is the I can't remember his name. He's a really great politician, a bad politician, but really good. He's the one who's he's a Bothan. I can't remember his name. He's such a conniving guy. I love him. He's such a conniving guy. I gotta look that up now. But anyway, so many good characters. So you've got Talon Card as well. Pelion is amazing. He's another favorite of mine. I'm gonna go ahead and look it up.
Yeah, so like and a thing that's interesting then, if like you pick these books up now and read them for the first time, like I did, I just read them within the last 6 months. I finished Heir to the Empire probably a month ago. It does a lot of setting up for things that come. Like, it talks about Rogue Squadron. It talks about it talks about the outbound flight. It does a lot of world building. Like, you're introduced to the planet of Coruscant for the first time. Although I don't think he had the idea that it's going to be a planet-wide city, because they talk about the Imperial city on Coruscant. But I mean, I don't expect everything
it,
to.
Yeah, it develops. So before Heir to the Empire, by the way, the Bothan I'm thinking of is Borsk Felya. He is in that. Oh, okay. He is in the trilogy there, right? I'm almost positive. Yeah. Okay. He's such a good character. I love him. I love the sort of corrupt, conniving politician. He's amazing. What was I going to say? What we were talking about before? We had...
You said how Coruscant developed.
Yeah, so before this book came out, there was no Coruscant. The capital actually had another name. I can't remember the name of the capital planet, but it had a different name. And Timothy Zahn, the author of Heir to the Empire, it came up with the name Coruscant for the capital. And it gets developed as it goes further. In fact, I don't think it's until Phantom Menace that we actually have an official understanding of Coruscant as a planet that's an entire planet that's just one city kind of thing. But yeah.
Yeah, no, and like part of me, like, because I'm kind of like an amateur historian, you know, I'm always reading history stuff. And the thing is, how much now it seems that George Lucas wanted to make the prequel, like he talked about them very early, like back in the early 80s when he had just finished, but he just talking about, you know, he's thinking things. So like, I don't know how much he had in his head. Cause in this book, Heir to the Empire, he talks about the Clone Wars. He brings it up like 10 times. Oh, back before the Clone Wars. And I think it hints that the Clone Wars spelled the end of the Jedi. It's hinted at. It doesn't say it outright. And like, in terms of the politics, I think it's actually fairly similar to what you see in Phantom Menace, because it talks about Palpatine. Of course, Palpatine's dead at this point. And it talks about how earlier in his life he was a senator. I saw that. I'm like, oh, okay. So in terms of politics, I think it's pretty advanced, the book. In terms of Jedi, it's very underdeveloped. There is no concept of a temple. Like, because the temple is right by the Imperial Palace in the prequel movies. So, like, Luke Skywalker's like, oh, I got to track down Jeru Sabaoth to learn about the Jedi. It's like, how come you just don't go into the temple archives, which is right close to the Imperial Palace?
Well, I think it gets destroyed. I think that's what it is. The archives, I think.
Really?
Yes. My understanding is that it is what's happened. But although it's not established, I don't think it's established in Heir to the Empire. I'm just saying, I think eventually that is what is sort of the story about it.
And a thing that's interesting is, Luke goes into the Imperial Archives, not the Jedi Temple, just the Imperial Archives, to look up Jeru Sabaoth.
Yeah.
And it's got nothing of a temple. It's like he was trained on the Jedi training center on planet so-and-so. I can't remember the planet offhand, but like, it gives kind of like a paragraph of on this date he became an official Jedi Knight. But there's nothing to do with the temple. So I think the temple is something that developed later. And like, I think that makes sense, because I think we touched on this in our last video, that Star Wars is not primarily about the Jedi. Yeah, they're part of the story, but it's kind of on the periphery almost. And
yeah, the The expanded universe, I mean, it does focus a lot on the Jedi, I would say. But what I love about the expanded universe is that it goes beyond that so much. It goes into, you know, the seedy parts of the Empire, into the rebellion versus the Empire. It's all sorts of different things. But sorry, go ahead. Yeah.
Well, yeah, and I'm just saying, like, I think that he had a good idea of what the politics were. Mm. But in terms of in terms of the Jedi, it kind of, and like, of course I could go in and pick them apart, because obviously from like 1991 to 1999, like adjustments are made. Obviously the idea of the temple is added, and in terms of politics, I could even, but like the historian in me kind of like wants to do like, how much did George Lucas know in 1990 or whatnot?
Yeah,
but yeah, so that's I did want to bring that up, and I think it plants a lot of eggs that seeds that eventually come to fruition, like the Rogue Squadron, the outbound flight, the a few other things as well, like Jason and Jaina. Yeah, sorry.
A few things. So Rogue Squadron is from the original trilogy. Just it does develop from the original trilogy.
Really?
Where? Yes. In The Empire Strikes Back, you see, well, Rogue Squadron is sort of in many ways a remnant of Red Squadron, which is the one with the Battle of Yavin. But you see Rogue Squadron as in Empire Strikes Back in the Battle of Hoth. So Wedge Antilles is there. They're referring to each other as Rogue. Rogue One, Rogue Five, etc. So that's where it gets into that. That's where it sort of develops from.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
The story of Rogue Squadron is obviously in the Rogue Squadron series, the book series, which is a decent one. I like it a lot. But then also the video games, the GameCube video games, go through the history of Rogue Squadron as well.
Yeah, I think the first one actually came out for N64.
Yes. And then it was a good game. I loved it.
Three came out for GameCube. And like all three of them are great games. They're really fun. And like, you get to fly as a whole bunch of ships, not just X-Wing. Although I love the X-Wing. I'd always pick that if I could.
My favorite was always the B-Wing, but Rogue Leader, Rogue Squadron 2 on GameCube, is, I think, still to this day, my favorite Star Wars game. I was always attracted to the space flight and stuff.
Knights of the Old Republic?
Yes. I love Knights of the Old Republic, don't get me wrong, but I was always attracted to being a starfighter in the Star Wars universe. I always loved the idea of the dogfights and stuff like that. And what I love about Rogue Squadron 2, Rogue Leader, is that they do their best to make the battles as authentic to the movies as possible. So when you're going through the Battle of Yavin, they're copying it as much as they can. You're going into the trench, and you really have very limited maneuvering. And then the Battle of Endor is still my favorite sort of level I've ever played in any Star Wars game. In that battle, you are fighting against two Star Destroyers. Like, you have to take down two Star Destroyers, and it is amazing. I love it.
Oh, and I think if you played X-Wing versus TIE Fighter and X-Wing Alliance as well.
I played it a little bit when I was a child, but I don't remember much of it. I played it on a PC, of course, obviously, but I haven't played it since. Not since I was like 7 or 8.
Okay. All right, let's get back to the book. And like, I think Thrawn, although now in the final book, Thrawn, like spoiler alert, if you don't want to get spoiled, change it to an R video now. On my channel, of course, so I get views. But in the third one, they kind of just kill off Thrawn, like, so, I don't know. It seemed like
easily
he deserved a better death.
Yeah, that is often considered one of the weaker points of the book. I love his final line, though, but, you know, it was so artfully done, something along those lines. And You know, it is what it is, but I think on the whole, I love the series. I mean, it's not a perfect trilogy, but it's still amazing. And I think that there is some sort of poetic justice to it because, you know, he's sort of considered by many to be the sort of noble bad guy. But at the end of the day, like the Nogri, he was like completely abusing and enslaved, you know? Yeah. So the idea that one of his own, like the trusted bodyguard thing, the idea that like one of his own most trusted bodyguard is like, he finds out that Thrawn has been just sort of like basically enslaving his group, his people on purpose. People. Yeah. It's just sort of like, oh, let me just kill you then. You know?
Yeah. Like I kind of notice when I think it was Leia is trying to do like all the diplomacy with the Nogri, and she has all the clout because she's the daughter of Darth Vader and they Darth Vader. Mm-hmm. And so I'm like, oh, that's interesting because Thrawn's kind of assassin guy is part of that group, right? And then it
his name was Rook, I think. I think his Rook, name was Rook, yeah. Right? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah. So there's something else I will want to get you to comment. I'm not sure because if I had to rank the books out of 10, I'd say Heir to the Empire is a solid 8. I'd give Dark Force Rising a solid 8. I'd probably give the third one a 7. It's still good. Don't get me wrong, but not as good as the first two. And a thing that was a big part of this whole trilogy is the character Jerusabaoth or Sabaoth?
Yes,
the clone of the Jedi.
So, another spoiler.
Yeah, and he's actually referenced in Plagueis.
Yeah,
very briefly. They just talk about like the top Sabaoth, Jedi are disagreeing. Is like, oh, you got Yoda on one side, Sabaoth on the other, and Mace Windu here. Oh, interesting. We're going to get to that in a bit. We just got to, in order, first Heir to the Empire. So, yeah, I don't know what to think about the Sabaoth story. It's a secondary story in the book.
It is. But and
I don't know what to think of it still. So I just want to hear your opinion on that.
So I don't hate at all the idea of Sabaoth being inserted into it. I think what was being thought was, especially since this is a pioneering book, this is one of the first Star Wars books, and you know, big Star Wars books especially. The idea is, I think what they're trying to do is recognize that Star Wars does have a fundamental aspect of it being the Force. And so they needed to have a sort of a contention or a sort of dispute within that sort of part of the story. So it's primarily a military sci-fi thing and political and all that sort of stuff, but it also has that Force element within it as well. And I think that's what Zahn was trying to do with it. I like it. I like Sabaoth as a bad guy. I think he's a great bad guy. He's just nowhere near Thrawn. So I recognize why they do it, but like they see as they're making more Star Wars books that the Force doesn't always have to be a central part of it, you know?
Yeah. And like, what was Thrawn? So like, did Thrawn have Sabaoth on his side to like, of course Luke's trying to find him because he wants to learn more about the Force and the Jedi and all that. But Thrawn has him to try to get the twins of the soon to be born twins of Leia and Han, who are probably going to be Force sensitive since they're the grandchildren of Darth Vader. But like it seemed like he was such a wild card. He was such a crazy guy because he was they talk about cloning a lot in these books. I think the Star Wars universe, they have really beat the clone thing to death. Like
there's an entire species that is just clones of themselves. They rather than reproducing, they just make clones of themselves. And they just name themselves like one of the famous ones is Dorsk 81 or something like that, meaning he's the 81st Dorsk in his line. You know?
Wow.
And they basically, the way they thought of themselves was like, oh, we're the perfect species. We've peaked. We can't get any better. So we're just going to keep repeating what we've been doing. So they're essentially repeating the same thing that their clone before them did, marrying the same person and, you know, living the same life, doing the same job and stuff. Yeah. Just as an example of the cloning sort of obsession.
Yeah. Like I'm not there quite yet. And I know there's, I don't know if you've read this, but I've heard there's a Thrawn duology that comes about 10 years later, where essentially, like, they obviously, I'm assuming that they make a clone of Thrawn. Cause I mean, he's killed at the end of, spoiler alert, he's killed at the end of Last Command, right? So I mean obviously they have to clone him, obviously.
Well, I can't tell you. You have to read it. It's a really good duology. It's a really good series. There's a more important spoiler that I won't give, but yeah, it turns out that there's a clone of him. But that's not all there is. There are other things happening too besides them being a clone of him.
Okay. Yeah, because I've heard very good things about those two books. Mm-hmm. And like, I want to, of course, I have a policy. Every five books I read, the fifth book has to be a novel. Has to be. Because mm-hmm. or else I won't read novels. So like, I put this rule in. And so like, I can do more if I want, but for sure, the fifth book has to be a novel. And that's what I... And like, I kind of give myself a project each year, you know. This year I'm going to do The Witcher, then I'm going to do classic books, then I'm going to do Leviathan Wakes. I can't remember.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah, I still got to do that one. They're sitting up there. I got the first four
books. I've been doing a lot of dystopian novels of late.
Oh, like what?
So I finished 1984. I'm reading Brave New World. Oh, I am going to try to trudge through Atlas Shrugged, but we'll see.
Atlas Shrugged is an interesting book. Let me tell you that. Like, I think that Ayn Rand, I'm not saying she does a good job of this, but she is probably the most tolerable. She can devote a whole book to an ideology and be constantly preaching at you. And the novel is actually not bad. I'm not going to say it's great, but it's not bad. Mm-hmm. And that's very hard. Like, you know, you think of a thing like God's not dead. Like obviously that's nauseating, right?
Yeah.
Including us, like we're believers, right? But like,
yeah.
So I think Ayn Rand is the best at preaching an ideology in novel form. Have you read any of her other books?
I've not read Fountainhead or any others. I know her to be a I hate Randianism, objectivism, the pseudo philosophy. I can't stand. I will say one of my favorite video game series is BioShock, which is a twist on Ayn Rand's John Galt and Atlas Shrugged and all that sort of stuff. In fact, there is a main character named Atlas in it. And the John Galt character is named Andrew Ryan, which is a direct play on the name Ayn Rand. So.
Well, you know where, who is it? You know where the title Atlas Shrugged comes from?
Well, from Atlas, though, carrying the world on his shoulders. Yeah,
like he's holding. Yeah. Like, there's this one scene in the book. It's like I couldn't find it for the life of me because that book's 1,100 pages, but it's on page like 400 or 500. They're just chatting in someone's office. I think it's Francisco D'Anconia and Eddie Willers or something. It's like, what does Atlas do when he holds the world over his head? And then he's like, I don't know, shrug. You know, like, that's where you get the whole title from. Apparently, it was supposed to be called Strike because all important people go on strike. And that makes a lot more sense. I wish they'd have stuck with that novel.
I think it does. I think the name does work well with it. I think because it's the idea of Atlas is, carrying the world on his shoulders, bearing the responsibility, doing all the heavy lifting. And then he's just tired of being hated and shrugs. And in other words, he gets rid of the world. He's like, okay, I'm not going to support the world anymore. Yeah. So I like the name. It makes sense to me, but yeah. Anyway, yeah, I can't stand Rand. Let's get back to Star Wars.
Okay, back to Star Wars. Okay, so we've talked about Sabaoth. So talk a bit about, because this story takes place about 5 years after Return of the Jedi, and it takes place in the span of, I think, about a year to 18 months. Because,
something like that.
Leia's pregnant at the beginning of the first one. And she gives birth in the third one. So that's about 9 months, maybe. And of course, it finishes shortly after. So probably close to a year. They're at war with Grand Admiral Thrawn. And is there anything else you want to cover in this trilogy?
I think we didn't talk about what people love about Thrawn or about other characters like Mara Jade. So Grand Admiral Thrawn is the sort of he's written like how Sherlock Holmes is written in the Holmes stories, where you're never getting the perspective in the writing from the position of Thrawn himself. It is always from Gilad Pelion, right? Pelion is his assistant. Yeah. I think he's the commander of the Chimera, I think, or something like that. Anyway,
he's a captain.
Or the captain. He's I captain don't know ranks very well. Okay. Yeah. So he is always the one who is observing Thrawn. And the reason for that is the same reason that you don't ever enter into the mind of Sherlock Holmes. You don't ever enter into the mind of Thrawn because he's just that intelligent. He is so intelligent, just like you don't ever enter into the mind of Sherlock Holmes because he's just that intelligent. And so that's one of the reasons that people love Thrawn. And he is, again, not that he's a perfect bad guy. There's no obviously such thing, but he's such a good bad guy. He is. There are two examples, I think. In one example, I can't remember exactly how it works out, but he, Darth Vader will just especially in Empire Strikes Back, he'll just kill any subordinate who doesn't go perfectly.
You have failed me for the last time, Admiral.
Yeah, just choke. Yeah. Thrawn. There was something, I think when Luke does that thing with the proton torpedo to get out of the tractor beam with his X-Wing, or was that was Luke, right? I think it was Luke. Do you remember that scene?
That's Luke.
It is Luke. Okay, yeah, I thought so. When Luke does the proton torpedo thing, so the tractor beam connects onto it instead of him, and then he gets out of the tractor beam and everything. So Thrawn talks to the tractor beam coordinator, operator, whatever it is. And he's asking him what happened. And, the guy's nervous and everything. He's like, well, this is what I did. I tried to do this to. And then Thrawn is like, well, that was a very good strategy. It failed, but good job. And he promotes him. I was like, that's so awesome. I love that. And he shows that he's willing to rule with an iron fist, but also he promotes ingenuity, and he promotes good work and all that sort of stuff. So it's not fear as much as a sort of respectful fear, a fear and respect for him. And I loved that.
Yeah, I thought that was, because in the first book, that scene you talked about is in the third book. In the first book, there's kind of a similar scene where the tractor beam guy screws up and Luke escapes, but not because Luke does anything clever. It's because the tractor beam guy screwed up, and it's like,
I'm getting them mixed up. Yeah,
it's two. There's two episodes are almost identical where Luke escapes, And uh-huh. the first one is like he screwed up. He has his throat slit. It's a very gruesome yeah. scene.
By Rook, yeah.
In the one, it's like the one that you just described. He okay. did the proton torpedo thing. It's like, oh, yeah, that's true. Tractor beams don't know how to defend against that yet. It's like, I'm promoting you, and I want you to work on a way to, if that happens again, stop know that, yeah. how to yeah, stop it. Yeah, so I thought that was good. A thing that also I liked about Thrawn mm-hmm. is that he likes to study the artwork of cultures, like to yes. know how they think. Yeah, mm-hmm. so he's like, oh, yeah, we're going to try to do diplomacy with this world. He's got, like, all their art. He's like, they seem mild but can be aggressive or something. Mm-hmm. That's just so unique. Like, I don't
know. I love it.
I don't know of any other bad guy that has had that. Like, I think they've had things like that for individual people. But in terms of, like, a whole race, I think that's pretty unique.
Well, it's important to note that Thrawn as a Chiss, by the way, we haven't talked about this. He is a Chiss. He is a blue-skinned humanoid with red eyes. Yeah, that's him on the right there. He is a very intelligent Chiss, even for his own species. Like, he's very, very intelligent. And the Chiss are in the unknown regions. So they're not really officially a part of either the Empire or the Republic or anything like that. It's called the Chiss Ascendancy. And they are sort of their own thing way out in the unknown regions. So people don't really know about the Chiss yet. The galaxy doesn't know about the Chiss, I should say.
And so do the Chiss show up in later books?
Yes. In fact, Outbound Flight, you'll see more Chiss, and Survivor's Quest, I think, as well. Both of them are written by Zahn, and they actually continue a lot of. Yeah, those are two books you really should read: Survivor's Quest and Outbound Flight.
And are they kind of like a duology, or?
They're not a duology, but they are both about Outbound Flight.
Okay, yeah, because they talk about the Project Outbound Flight, like the pre-Clone Wars thing where they call him the Emperor. They don't call him Supreme Chancellor. But I'm like, I can see them using that anachronistically. They do the mission Beyond the Galaxy or something?
Yeah.
Or Beyond the Other Room or something like that. Like way out
in Nether. I think it's Survivor's Quest. I just want to double check. I'm looking it up because I think that's the one I'm thinking of. Yeah, I think that's the one I'm thinking of. Yeah, Survivor's Quest. It deals with. It's not the one I'm thinking of. Oh yeah. Yep. This is it. Yeah, it's the one with that talks more about the Chiss. Yeah.
Okay, yeah, because I mean, because I'm just getting into this stuff. I'm, because I think at the time I'd only read, I think half a dozen books at the time of our first talk. Mm-hmm. Now I've read four more, and I plan on reading at least that many this year. I know the next seven because I got seven books.
What are the other ones you're looking at again?
Okay, so I'll talk about that at the. I suppose I could. Well, in terms of new, like post Return of the Jedi, like the first book were those three, those Heir to the Empire trilogy. But the next trilogy written is the Jedi Academy trilogy, and it's got Champions of the Jedi Search, Dark Apprentice, and Champions of the Force. They're the next books written after Heir of the Empire. And so I've got these. And then I got some a couple Old Republic books. I've had this book for years, Revan, just lying around, obviously, because I love the game. The first game, I didn't find the second game as good.
I never finished the second game.
Yeah, it's not that good. It's not that good. I'm like, what's the point of this game? You know, but the first one is excellent.
It is.
Then the Darth Bane. which takes place about 1,000 years before the movies. And so, like,
Darth Bane is one of my favorite Sith. He's right there with Palpatine, and I Palpatine was not even close to my favorite Sith until I read Darth Plagueis.
Yeah, no, Plagueis. Well, I guess this is a perfect transition. All right, let's. We are.
Well, I mean, it's up to you. Do whatever you want. Yeah.
Well, do you have any last thoughts about Heir to the Empire and that trilogy?
Yeah. Let's see. It's a great trilogy. I think it. It's centrally important. If anyone is interested in reading the expanded universe, start with the Heir to the Empire with the Thrawn trilogy, and that will tell you whether or not you're going to like the rest of the expanded universe, because that's sort of the gold standard for the old pre-Disney canon.
I kind of feel bad, because if those are the best books, that means it's all downhill from here.
No, not the best. It's the gold standard. I'm sorry. I don't mean by the best by that. Like, everything is sort of compared to that, you know? So there are things that are better. It's just that it sort of sets the tone for the rest of the series, the whole expanded universe.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Now let's talk about Plagueis. Plagueis, as you know, he's actually mentioned in the movies. In Revenge of the Sith, there's that dialogue between Palpatine and Anakin. It's like, oh, have you ever heard the story of Plagueis the Wise? It's like, no. It's like, oh, the Jedi wouldn't talk about him, you know? And how he's the Darth Lord of the Sith, and, you know, how he knew how to create life, and his apprentice killed him. So this book is, I just want to say something about the author, James Luceno. He has written quite a few Star Wars books, including this one. This one takes place right before. It's called Labyrinth of Evil. It's right before The Revenge of the Sith, the movie, written by James. In fact, it explains how come there's like a space battle at the start of the movie. It explains that here. And he also wrote Dark Lord, The Rise of Darth Vader, which takes place a couple weeks after Revenge of the Sith. I tried to find my copy, but I can't find it for some reason. Anyway, both written by James Luceno. Apparently, he's written a grand total of 10 books, including a couple in the Disney canon. So that just shows how good even Disney wanted to have his talent in there.
Yeah. James Luceno is really good. Yeah.
Yeah, no, he's a great Star Wars author. He's written a few books outside of Star Wars, but that need not concern us now. So, Plagueis. Now, Plagueis, you introduced the book, and now I'll comment later.
Yeah, Darth Plagueis is about who Plagueis is. Now, in the Revenge of the Sith, you get literally just one speech about Plagueis. You know almost nothing about it. Although, given the way Palpatine talks about Plagueis, you get the sense that Plagueis was his master, because he has that like evil smile when he talks about him getting killed and all that sort of stuff, you know? So you get this indication that like, oh, Plagueis was his master kind of thing. That's only implied at most, but Plagueis is about Darth Plagueis. And what I love is that it starts with Plagueis as the apprentice of the Sith. So his master is Darth Tenebris, who is, I love this too, Darth Tenebris is a Bith. And if you don't remember what a Bith is, the Bith are the people playing the jazz music in the Mos Eisley Cantina with like the alien, big alien eyes and the bald heads and stuff. So the idea that one of those guys is a Sith Lord is just amazing. I love it. Plagueis is a moon. I think, or Mune. I can't remember how to pronounce it. M-U-U-N.
Yeah, it's spelled M-U-U-N.
Yeah.
There's actually, because they're big into the banking clan, and there's actually, in Attack of the Clones, they show a representative of the banking clan. It's like, we're going to join the separatists. You know, it has him talking to Count Dooku. So he's part of those people. There's a picture of him on the front here, talking to to Palpatine. It kind of looks like he's like Supreme Leader Snoke here.
Yeah,
but
this is way before Snoke. Yeah,
way before Snoke, and Snoke's not in this timeline anyway. So
thank God.
Yeah, so like I kind of the thing I like the most about this book is that this book is a prequel of the prequels. It has a ton of the characters that are in the prequels and some that are only briefly mentioned, like Master Sifo-Dyas,
Count Dooku,
Chancellor Valorum. Count Dooku's in this book. In fact, he's it shows in this book that he was super good friends with Master Sifo-Dyas. And like it shows how come Count Dooku quit the Jedi, and stuff like that. And a lot of backstory that I think, and like it explains how come at the very beginning of the Phantom Menace there's a blockade of Naboo by the Trade Federation. It explains why they're doing the blockade. Like it's part of the Sith master plan, right? The grand plan.
Exactly.
And it just fits like a glove. In fact, Padme's even in this.
Yes. What I love about this book is that all the silliness that's in the prequels gets explained away as much and as best as possible. So like the fact that a 14-year-old is an elected leader of a planet is explained away, you know. Midichlorians are made to be actually cool, you know.
The midichlorians, yeah. No, and like they kind of hint at like when Count Dooku's talking about how he's not liking where the Republic and the Jedi Council are going. He's talking about the Jedi Council. It's like, oh, they're obsessed with prophecy now. That's all they talk about, you know. They're searching for the one who will bring balance to the Force and all this stuff.
Yep.
And oh, they claim they found him on some desert planet. He's like, I can't take this stuff anymore, you know.
Yeah.
And then he leaves the Order, right?
Yeah. Well, and another thing I love is what I love about Plagueis is that it is so reflective of our society today. So the Sith are, you know, ever since Bane, are learning that essentially infiltration is the only way that they will be able to take over the galaxy, right? Because the Sith are ultimately feeding on themselves. They're very cannibalistic. I don't mean that literally, obviously. In that, you know, with that understood, like they are, you know, for centuries and centuries, they are working their way into the higher up positions of society to then one day be able to take it over. And that's what ends up happening with Revenge of the Sith and all that sort of stuff. And that is so reflective of our society. When you look at sort of liberalism and leftism, they're slowly taking over the institutions and overturning them ever so subtly. And then that's how
the Curia
take over. Say it.
Like you're, but I don't want to talk about that now. Where that's not the topic of this. But no, but that's actually a really good point. I haven't thought of that. They're like, yeah, the only way we need to like, instead of taking it over from the, because tons of changes in society, people think are just organic. Oh, as we get more advanced, we become more like this. And it's like, no, a lot of this was imposed from above. Not all of it, but a good chunk of it was.
Go ahead.
No. You can go.
Well, like the overturning of the institution of the Jedi, right? So the Jedi are seen as corrupt by the end of the episode 3, by the end of Revenge of the Sith. And I think of the Jedi as reflective of Christianity, kind of thing. And so the institution of Christianity is being sort of undermined by the left. And so I see the Sith sort of being like the way we destroy the Jedi is not by a direct conflict with the Jedi, but in a way making them look as just corrupt and as tools of the government and as tools of the, you know, the highest bidder and all that sort of stuff. And so I see that sort of same thing in the real world, where there's this idea of where even Christians today hate the institution of the church. You know, it's not a religion, it's a relationship, that sort of thing, undermining the actual institution, you know?
Hear, hear. Yeah, no, no.
And to expand on that, sorry, one more thing. To expand on that, what I love about the old expanded universe is that there are so many Christian morals within it. Just like that itself. I mean, that's in the trilogy, the prequel trilogy as well. But you know, it's more focused upon in this book as well. You know, things like Mara Jade is pro-life in Star Wars. Without spoiling too much, she ends up being pregnant within marriage, and I won't say, you know, what happens there, other than, you know, she ends up being pregnant within marriage. She's sick at the time. She has a deadly unknown disease, and something it is that's like sort of slowly killing her. So she's afraid. She goes, well, wait a minute. What if this pregnancy kills me because of my disease, you know? And, you know, what if I pass it on to my child? And then she goes, you know, there are ways to get, you know, out of this. And she's like, no, there's no way I'm going to destroy my, you know, kill my own baby. And I was like, oh, yeah, I love that.
Automatically so, your favorite character then.
Yeah, I love Mara Jade. I've had a crush on Mara Jade ever since I was a child. She's my Star Wars crush.
She's very weird because she was like a servant of the Emperor, and she was given the task of killing Luke, and then she's like, I need to kill Luke. You know, she'll like openly say it in front of like Han and Leia.
I need to kill you.
It's like, I need to kill you, you know. It's like, and then that lust for killing Luke gets satisfied. Spoiler alert, turn it off if you don't want to hear this. When she kills a clone of Luke that Sabaoth had. I think that was kind of interesting. Yeah. What did you find odd about the way Plagueis got killed? Like you talked about how, like, it sounds like
another spoiler. Palpatine was,
well, no, it's not a spoiler alert. Because Palpatine was the apprentice of Plagueis. Mm-hmm.
Well, let me say that I actually, one of the reasons I love the book Darth Plagueis is that it focuses heavily upon the politics of Star Wars. And I'm weird. I love the politics of Star Wars. I really love, like, you'll especially love it during what's called the New Jedi Order, which is the other big series that you'll need to read, as well as Legacy of the Force. Legacy of the Force really gets into really good political stuff, but like, both of those series do really great with politics. In fact, at one point there's a bit of a triumvirate of three characters. I won't name them, where it's a sort of triumvirate of an uneasy alliance, politically. I love it. Darth Plagueis focuses heavily on politics, not too much, I would say, where there are other plenty of really good things. There is the death of Plagueis that happens, and, you know, I'll say this. Some people don't like it, how he dies, where basically he's, you know, Force Lightning, you know, he's obviously killed by his own apprentice, which is Palpatine, and he's drunk at the time. Like, they're celebrating, I think they're celebrating Palpatine's rise to the chancellorship, right, or something like that. What were they celebrating? I can't remember.
They're like... it's not, yes, like the election hasn't happened yet, but it's pretty much a shoo-in because the two other candidates are quite problematic in various ways. So they're like celebrating. It's a bit premature, but it's essentially foregone conclusion. You know, they're Palpatine just getting him drunk. Oh, have some more wine. You know.
Yeah. So then Palpatine kills him with Force Lightning and stuff. And, you know, some people found that, you know, like, oh, how dare they? And like, I like those sorts of deaths. I actually like the Thrawn death. I think it's done well. Some people don't like it. I mean, I can see why people don't like it. I can see how it's a bit weak, and I can empathize with that. But I like it at the end of the day. And same thing with Plagueis' death. I like that. I love it when the sort of like very powerful, very smart, very you know, very formidable enemy ends up getting killed in a very sort of simple way. I like it. I think it can be done very well. And I think both of them were done pretty well.
What slightly off topic in the yeah. movie, we're going to the Disney canon.
Yeah.
The Last Jedi. Do you like how they killed off Luke or?
The Last Jedi. Oh, I hate that. No. Well, I mean, first of all, he's not a bad guy. I'm talking about like bad guys getting killed very simply.
Yeah, I know, but like it's kind of like a simple death. And like that death of Luke was so polarizing. Some people were like, "Oh, what are you doing?" And some people were like, "Oh, you know, that was kind of, you know, he just kind of goes into oblivion, you know."
Yeah, I don't like it. I don't like how they dealt with almost anything in the sequel trilogy. I really tried to like The Last Jedi. In fact, with The Last Jedi, I would almost forgive it if they had changed only one, like if they changed even just this one thing, which I'm about to say, I would be like, oh, it's actually a decent movie. If they had made Rey join Kylo Ren on the dark side, if they had done that, Yes. That would have forgiven so many of the mistakes that they made in that movie.
Yeah, because they kill off Snoke, and I'm like, okay, that's a bit odd. Seems a bit premature.
Yeah.
But, like, who's the big bad guy now? Okay, there's Kylo Ren, but at this point, we know Rey is stronger than Kylo Ren. So it's kind of like...
It's the Mary Sue problem. There's kind of no point.
Yeah, so that's why in the third movie, which I thought was... an abomination. They essentially had to bring back Palpatine. They don't explain it at all, and it apparently that contradicted even a lot of the established Disney canon lore.
Oh, I don't know.
He's like, I created Snoke, because so apparently it says in the novel for The Force Awakens that Snoke had been old enough to see the rise and the demise of the Galactic Empire. And instead Palpatine's like, I created Snoke, right? So they were kind of in a rock and a hard place, because Rian Johnson and J.J. Abrams had two completely different visions, and since Johnson screwed it up, it's like, all right, Abrams, you get to finish it off. Well, he's already closed all those plot holes, so he had nothing to do. I don't blame him for it, but
I'm somewhat convinced that Rian Johnson was just really being like, I want to screw like with this just for fun. That's the only way I can explain it. I'm not even like, I say it in a funny way, but like, I don't even like, I think because he's not a bad director. Like he does decent stuff. It's just that one is so horrible.
Knives Out.
The Last Jedi is just so hard. Yeah. Knives Out was great. But yeah, that is just so horrible. That The Last Jedi, that, it's like I think he purposefully kind of screwed with it.
There's no other explanation. He purposely sabotaged the franchise.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, no.
Maybe that's a good thing. Maybe that's a good thing because I hate the Disney canon. So.
Well, and the thing is, after the Force Awakens, I thought that was okay. This could be a good series. Like essentially they plagiarize A New Hope, but A New Hope's a good movie. Yeah. So I mean, if you're gonna have a knockoff of something good, it's gonna be almost as good. But The Last Jedi and The Rise of Skywalker were horrible. Like
I have a bit more sympathy for The Rise of Skywalker.
I don't.
Well, I have sympathy for it because I think J.J. Abrams was trying to do as best as he could, and given what cards Rian Johnson gave him, it's like, this is the best I can do. I'm sorry.
I think the last movie is worse than The Last Jedi, but I blame The Last Jedi for why it's worse. And I think you probably agree with me there. But a thing I do like about The Last Jedi was the lightspeed kamikaze. I like that scene.
The lights being kamikaze?
Yeah, like when Admiral Holdo, like...
Lightspeed kamikaze, yeah.
Yeah.
No, there is actually a super weapon made by the Empire in the Expanded Universe that kind of plays with that idea. It's called the Galaxy Gun. The Sun Crusher is different. There is one called the Galaxy Gun. It basically sort of shoots a sort of light speed bullet, basically. And the Sun Crusher is another very interesting one. It makes suns go supernova, and it's basically impervious to any sort of blaster fire. It's a very small, like about the size of a starfighter kind of thing. Anglicans and Romanists unite in an ecumenical council to condemn the heresy of Disney Star Wars movies.
Yes. Here, here. We're united.
True ecumenism. Okay. Amen.
Yes, that's noble ecumenism, you know.
Yes,
that's I fully approve of this kind of ecumenism. Just getting back to this book, else I noticed in this book, the Sith, in this case Plagueis and Tenebris and
Sidious,
they're very they kind of, this may be blasphemy, but the way they constantly quoted the old Sith, they kind of reminded me of trad Catholics quoting Aquinas, right? You know, like with Bane. Like, no. Bane is the Aquinas of the Sith Order. Like, he is, like, kind of a guy. And, of course, there's other good Sith to look to. And, they bring up Malak and Revan and...
Yeah. No, I love the Sith in Star Wars, especially in the expanded universe. There's such a sort of religious fervor. They're evil, obviously, but they have such a devotion.
They talk about Korriban and Droman Kaas and all those places.
Yeah.
And I think this is the only one I've read from a Sith perspective. Although next I will probably soon be reading this trilogy.
You will love that trilogy.
I kind of want to, because this is kind of like giving me an appetite from books from a Sith perspective.
Yeah, if you like, if you like the Sith in Plagueis, you will love Bane. So let me set it up for you a little bit without spoiling things. The Sith Brotherhood, I think it's called the Brotherhood of Darkness at this point, because there's been so much infighting since the fall of Revan and all that sort of stuff, they sort of try to treat each other as all equals. So people keep joining the Sith and all that, but it's sort of like a commune of Sith where no one is above the other kind of thing. But you can't do that with the Sith. Obviously, Bane is the one who develops the Rule of Two. And the book does not start with him as a Sith. It starts with him before he joins the Sith and all that sort of stuff. But he enters into the Sith eventually and just sees this mess of Sith, basically just constantly killing each other, but no one's above each other and all this sort of stuff. He's like, we gotta get rid of this. So
no can do.
It's and there is a character named Lord Hoth, who is a Jedi. And this series has an interesting take on the Jedi, because this is sort of seen as some of the high moments of the Republic and all that, or the high moments of the Jedi. But Lord Hoth is just not a good character kind of thing. I don't want to give too much away, but it's such a good trilogy. I love it.
Well, in Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic, I know that's pre-Bane, but they're it's an entire empire. There's a Sith empire there. They have Sith troopers and tons of Sith. You got Dark Jedi, but there's only two Sith lords. There's the Dark Lord Sith and his apprentice, who are in charge of everything.
Well, not only, there are others.
Is that how, well, like I got the impression that they're the master and the apprentice of the Sith run the Sith Empire. Cause like, if you take a look at,
oh, they do. Yeah.
Riven and Malak, they ran the Sith Empire, and then obviously Malak turned on Revan and all that stuff. Yeah. So like, is that kind of like the same thing in here? You have the Sith Empire and you have the master and the apprentice in charge.
So I don't want to give away too much.
Okay.
I'm trying to debate how much I should tell you, but Revan does point out this issue in the Sith, where there's this problem of constant infighting. And so while Bane is the one who establishes the rule of two, Revan talks about how like this is a problem. So prior to
is that in here?
Bane, I don't know if he talks about it in there. It is mentioned, and I'm trying not to get too much information. It is mentioned in, is that the Revan one?
Yeah.
I don't think I've read that one. Yeah, I've not read that one. But I'm trying to not give too much information. But okay. It is mentioned in the first book of the Darth Bane trilogy. What I'm talking about. It's referred to in the trilogy. So, So what am I saying? Okay. So in say like, Knights of the Old Republic, in, you know, the Revan era and the, all that, you do still have that master apprentice thing, right? But there are other Sith, and by Sith, I mean, acolytes and such, right? Where it's not this thing where like only two people can be, you know, masters of the dark side of the force, you know, a master and apprentice kind of thing. You can have other ones, but there are always going to be those sort of two, the master and the apprentice that are in charge of everything. What Bane's idea is, he reduces it to like, now there's only the master and the apprentice, right? To where no one else gets the title Sith, no one else.
Except the Dark Lord and his apprentice.
The Dark Lord of the Sith and then his apprentice.
I'm really looking forward
to. Yeah, it's a good series. It's really good. I mean, it's dark. Don't get me wrong. It's dark. You end up not liking Bane, I would expect. But you don't like him the same way you don't like Palpatine, you know? Like, I like and don't like Palpatine. And same as like with Bane. Bane is another favorite of mine. I like and do not like Bane. He's very evil.
Well, like you talked about in our first video, where you go the 10, like the top 10. You talk about the first book in the Legacy of the Force, where it's got Jacen Solo, and he's being all like. Conniving and
yeah,
like ruthless in a way. Like is that the kind of thing that Darth Bane is?
No. Bane. So Darth Cadus. Well, spoiler. Sorry, Darth Cadus. Jacen Solo is one of those where you can very much empathize with his turn to the dark side. Bane, you can feel sorry for him because of his life, but like he is evil, you know, like you cannot imagine Bane being like, I'm sorry, as he's killing somebody. Like Cadus is like that. Yeah. Cadus is like that. He kills. Yeah. He's like, I'm sorry, but I just have to do this. You know, like Cadus actually apologizes to a particular character, a main character that he kills. And it's a whole, it's a great bittersweet scene. I won't say anything about it, but it's a very powerful scene. But he apologizes because he loves this person that he's ending up killing, whom he's fighting against. Bane, you're not gonna get anything quite like Cadus.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Bane is just the completely ruthless, no conscience at all type guy.
I want to get back when you read the first book.
Okay. So
yeah, I don't want to give anything away. Yeah.
The next book I'm reading is Revan. It's a short book. It's 340 pages. Plagueis was 460. And then I will start on the three main books. And then, so probably maybe 6 months from now, we'll do another Star Wars stream. Does that sound good?
That sounds good. I might read Revan. I was never a huge fan of Revan, not because I dislike him. I just was not as much of a fan of Revan as everybody else was, if that makes sense. It's kind of like the same thing with Harry Potter. I've never hated Harry Potter. I've just kind of been annoyed with how obsessed people are with Harry Potter. So likewise, I've always been kind of annoyed at how obsessed people are with Revan. So I've never really cared for Revan because of that. So I would usually sort of avoid anything of his other than like KOTOR, which is a great game. You know, it's a good game.
Yeah.
Really good.
Yeah. The game. First one, especially.
Yeah. So when I saw the Revan book, I'm just like, okay, whatever. I don't care. I actually really love the old Sith, like way before Revan even. So like Nagasato, Mark Aragnos, and those sorts of characters, they are amazing as bad guys. They're just sort of so. They're amazing.
Are those the ones that are part of the Sith tribe, like the Sith peoples?
No, they are not from. They discover. I think Mark Aragnos is the one who discovers the Sith on Korriban, I think. I'm trying to remember my Sith mythology. I can't remember it too well right now, unfortunately. Mark Aragnos, I think, is the one who discovers the Sith species, right? Or no, maybe not. I don't. It's been a while. Sorry. I'm gonna probably get a lot of that wrong, so I'm not gonna go too much into it. But yeah, it's from sort of like the idea is that these are sort of like godlike. Sith with like amazing, like they are sorcerers basically, kind of thing. They make like the modern Sith look very weak in comparison, although I would say possibly with the exception of Palpatine. Palpatine is definitely one of the most powerful Sith, if not possibly the most powerful Sith, I would say.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm going to I'm curious. Have you read a book? It's part of a legend. It was actually one of the last books prior to Disney acquiring it, but it's just called Kenobi.
I did not read it. No.
Okay, so I'll tell you what. I'm going to read this, and then I'm going to read these. And then I'll touch base with you. We'll both read Kenobi, and then we'll talk about these five books. That sound good?
Okay. Yeah, I'll try. I'll definitely want to read Revan. And I don't think I own the book Kenobi, so I'll see if I can find it. And if I can find it, then I'll read it.
You can find it. But the question is, can you find it without the bar?
Yes. I'm going to. Actually, let me see right now. I can find
it. And there's probably not a lot of used copies out there because it came out, I think, in 2013. And
yeah,
Disney acquires Lucasfilm in 2014. So
well, I can always get the Audible version. I'm fine with getting an Audible version of it. So
or Kindle or
well, there's an Audible version I see. So okay. I'll probably get the Audible.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine.
The one by John Jackson Miller?
Yes.
All right.
Yeah, he's written a few. Because there's this guy I follow on YouTube. His name is Jonathan Cohn, K-O-A-N. And okay. He does like a lot of like Star Wars stuff. He did this one, not that. And like he's read both canons, actually. Like he's read lots of like of Legends plus new canon stuff, and it's sometimes interesting to hear him talk about new canon. And then he's got this video that I'm going to in fact I may add this to the stream briefly. Share screen, Chrome. Do you see the screen?
Yes, I do.
Okay. And in this one, he ranks my channel. My name all is his Jonathan Cohn, and today Legends books.
The rest of the books.
Oh, he's at Revan.
Right there.
I mean, among my friends. Next, I have the Han Solo trilogy all in a one bind up.
That was a decent trilogy. Not amazing, but it's okay.
Daily. I don't own the
Do you want to go through this entire video? It's 27 minutes, but
no, it's okay.
But no, he like talks about them all, and I go through. I'm like, what would Father James say about this one or that one or? But
I'm if you want to go over and ask particular ones, I'm fine with doing that. I just don't know if I'd be up for the entire thing.
Well, I'll tell you what. I'll go through the timeline, and then I'll.
Okay.
Here we got to take. Sure thing. In fact, I thought about asking, sending an invite to Jonathan, asking him to come on my
channel. Oh, nice! I would love to be on that too. Then.
Yeah. No. Like. Yeah. If he comes, I'll make sure you're on. Okay. So I've got. Okay. What do you think about the X-Wing books?
Wait. Sorry. One second. Timeline. So I didn't read the entire thing, and it's been a while since I've read that. So I would say, from my recollection, I liked it. I'll say that.
Have you read any of the Old Republic apart from Bane, like the ones from like 4,000 years ago?
There are not that many books that I recall that are part of it.
Yeah. Yeah, there's four
it's
here.
It's more there's... of... Yeah. There are not that many, but it tends to be more comics. So I've read some of the comics on it, but not the, where is it? Sorry, but not the not any of the other books.
And you've read a Splinter in the Mind's Eye, then?
Yes, that one's okay. Okay, it's not amazing. Yeah.
Apparently, there's a love story between Luke and Leia, which is. Awfully awkward in hindsight. Dark Lord, The Rise of Darth Vader. Have you read that one? That's one of the few I've read.
No, I did not read that one. No, no.
Okay. Okay. I think it's worth reading. Have you read one called Knight Errant?
That sounds familiar, but it did not impact me much.
Okay, yeah, because that's takes place about 30 years before the Darth Bane Plagueis. We obviously talked about that. Rogue Planet.
Rogue Planet is I remember that one. I'm trying to remember if I liked it or not. I didn't hate it. I remember appreciating it. Like I thought it was okay. Yeah.
A friend of mine who read that one, I didn't read it, said that, like, because that book came out at the same time they're writing the new Jedi Order book.
New so Jedi Order, of, yeah.
Yeah, so they threw out some Yuuzhan Vong Easter eggs, right?
Yeah. Yeah, they do. Rogue Planet is about, I can't remember the name of the planet, but yeah, it's tied intimately with the lore of the Yuuzhan Vong.
Okay. The Han Solo trilogy.
Yeah, it's all right. It's not I'm not amazed by it, but it's all right. It's pretty good.
If you had to rank it out of 10.
Within the Star Wars itself, I would put it maybe at like a 6. Like a high 5, low 6, around that.
Okay. What about I know Tales of the Bounty Hunters is one of your favorite books.
Really good. Yes.
Have you read Tales from Jabba's Palace?
I think I read it when I was very young. I don't remember a lot of it, but I remember liking what I read of it.
Have you read the Bounty Hunter Wars?
Yeah. That one's, I loved it. I don't think I would go back and love it as much. Is that the one? Wait, I might be thinking of the wrong one. Is that the trilogy, the Boba Fett trilogy?
It's a trilogy. The Mandalorian armor, slave yeah. ship, and hard merchandise.
Yeah. That one, so I did love it when I was a kid. It's a bit silly because it basically makes Boba Fett a Mary Sue in it. He's basically, he can do no wrong. So it's looking back on it, I'm not a big fan of it anymore, but it's, you know, it's the series that got me to love Boba Fett. I'll say that.
I know you're.
Oh, he also, Boba Fett in that series, condemns premarital sex.
Ooh. There's some good people, you know, there's anti-abortion, anti-premarital yeah. sex.
Well, yeah. well, he literally condemns premarital sex.
Well, okay, I got a confession to make. I only read these books because I lost a bet with my cousin, but I've read the Twilight books, and they condemn premarital sex in those.
So, it's definitely better than the Twilight series. So I love vampires. I really love, they're one of my favorite mythical, they're probably my favorite mythical creature.
Including when they sparkle. Oh,
I tried to read Twilight. I tried to like it because it's about vampires. I'm like, okay, well, I got to read this. So I started reading it. I was hating it. And then when it got to the part where the vampire kid sparkled, I threw the book. I was just like, okay, I can't do this. I can't do this anymore.
Yeah, I lost a bet with my cousin Kathy. Shout out to Kathy if you're watching, which I know she isn't. Okay, have you read
I forgot Rogue Planet. It was written by Greg Bear. Greg Bear is an interesting author. He did some Halo novels, if I recall correctly.
Yeah, a lot of these authors.
He did the Forerunner series, didn't he?
Sci-fi.
Yeah. He did the Forerunner saga, I think. Zanama Sakat is the name of the planet.
Oh, that's the one then. If you read these.
Let me see.
This is the Jedi Academy trilogy.
So I get that mixed up with the Young Jedi Knights. I think I've read both, but I can't separate them in my mind from each other because I read them both around the same time. The Young Jedi Knights is more of a young adult series. And then the Jedi Academy is different. I get them mixed up. I read both of those when I was like preteen, you know?
Have you read I, Jedi?
Yes, that's. I think that might be the only Star Wars book that is written fully in first person. It's about Corran Horn.
Yeah, it's about Corran Horn. I didn't know about the first person thing.
Yeah.
Have you read Darksaber?
I don't think I read it. But that is about the Hutts trying to build basically basically the Death Star laser just itself, and it's called the Darksaber. So it's basically just like a ship with the Death Star laser. Yeah.
Have you read the Black Fleet Crisis trilogy?
Oh, I don't think I did. No.
Have you read the Corellian trilogy?
Yes. That's the one with Center Point, if I recall correctly. Yes.
It's Ambush at Corellia, Assault on Salonia,
Showdown at Center Point. Okay. Yep.
Yeah, and then the next is the Hand of Thrawn duology.
I recommend it. I do recommend it. And then there's
a couple standalone books.
Survivor's Quest, Outbound Flight. Yeah. Well, Outbound Flight is prequel era, but yeah.
And then after that, it's pretty much series of books. Like you got the New Jedi Order, the Darkness, the Legacy of the Force, and the Fate of the Jedi. And there's a standalone book, Crucible, at the
Vector Prime. Yeah, Vector Prime signals sort of a new era of Star Wars books. So if Heir to the Empire is a paradigm shift for Star Wars, Vector Prime is another paradigm shift in many, many ways. If you read the book Vector Prime, I don't want to give away much, but there's a, within the story itself, there is a paradigm shift. And there's a bit of an almost fourth wall breaking recognition of it as a paradigm shift. I really don't want to give away anything beyond that. It might sound silly the way I'm saying it, but it's worth reading it. Do not let it get spoiled. It's a good book. But okay. It's also a paradigm. Do you know anything about Vector Prime, by the way?
Yeah, that's the only New Jedi Order book I've read. I've read Vector.
Oh, Prime. You have read it. Oh, you have read it. Yeah. Okay. Okay, yeah. So, spoiler alert, it's Chewbacca, right. And they even talk about it at the end. It's like, you know, I used to think that our crew, like our core group, would never get killed. Now I feel like no one's safe anymore. It's like, that's speaking to the audience, saying, expect more main characters to die. Yeah.
It's like, all right, they've had that aura of invincibility. All that's gone.
Yeah,
now.
The plot armor is gone now. Yeah. But like Vector Prime signals a new era of Star Wars expanded universe where they're being more sort of collected and organized as like, we're doing series now. We're working, consciously working together, not just trying to sort of adjust things and all that sort of stuff, where it was kind of just sort of like wild space of like all these sort of disparate stories trying to be woven together. It's like, no, we're working together now. So you've got the NJO series, which is like 24 books or something like that. I want to say it's a lot of books. And then you got the Legacy of the Force. Well, you've got the Joiner Nest and all that, the trilogy.
Yeah, the Dark Nest Trody, the Joiner King, the Unseen Queen, and the Swarm War.
Yeah, but like the Legacy of the Force is the big one that I would say, the other big one from there. I'm in a bit of a unique position because I grew up reading these books before as they were getting published, you know. So I'm reading the Young Jedi Knight series, and I'm, you know, as a preteen and then into my teen years. I'm growing up with Jason and Jaina and Anakin Solo, and then I'm reading the Vector Prime and the NJO series as I'm a later teen and early 20s and all that sort of stuff. And then so I'm growing up watching these characters develop. And then to read Betrayal, which is the first book of Legacy of the Force, and to watch your
number two book.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite books. Yeah, it's amazing. And to watch, to watch that turn. I knew it was happening, but I refused, you know, because I grew up reading Jason Solo as this sort of pacifist animal lover, you know, and just to watch sort of his life change and evolve because of, you know, the New Jedi Order series and because of Vergeer and all that sort of stuff. It's just, yeah.
Have you read the Fate of the Jedi?
No, I've not gotten that far. I did not read The Fate of the Jedi. My last one was the Legacy of the Force.
Yeah, because like I got a long way to go with this. It'll take me years to finish it.
Oh, yeah.
Well,
yeah.
I mean, I suppose I could, if I wanted to, for a whole year, I could, because I read about 40 or 50 books a year. Like I'm on pace for about 40 this year. I did 50 last year. I mean, if I wanted to, I could probably only do Star Wars novels for 1 year, just take a year off apologetics. But I mean, I'm trying to grow my
channel. Take a jubilee. Just take a jubilee year.
Oh, yeah, no, but I mean, I'd love fiction, but like most of my reading is still nonfiction. Now, change of topic. What are you reading right now? Like not Star Wars necessarily, or for all I know you could be, but are you
I'm reading Brave New World. I kind of put a pause on that, but I've been reading Brave New World. My focus has been let's see I've been doing a bit of typology reading, especially messianic prophecies in the Old Testament about Jesus. Going directly to scripture with that. I'm sorry?
Which author?
No, reading, like studying it myself.
Okay.
Yeah. So I've been doing a lot of studying on typology, but that's because I'm teaching a class on messianic prophecies and things like that for my church right now. So I've been doing that a lot. So a lot of my reading has been focused upon church stuff, right? What other books am I reading? I got to look at my list. I do have a list. My Audible, because I use a lot of Audible as well. The next dystopian novel that I'm going to be reading is Fahrenheit 451. Let's see. That's a fun one.
The Mechanical Hound.
I've never actually read it before, Let's see. Ooh, I have The Sandman. That's another one that I'll have to be getting into soon. I've never read that one. Yeah. So basically just right now, I'm pretty light on reading right now. I admittedly, I've been playing a lot of Resident Evil of late. So that's taking more of my time recently.
The first three?
The first one. And I also have Resident Evil Zero, which I think I'm going to play that as well.
Because I have that one too. That one's hard to find, actually.
Well, I have it on Steam. I actually owned it when I had a GameCube as a teenager, but I never played it. I bought it and didn't play it yet.
That one was that's an interesting one. Like it's it's a prequel, right? The books the next book I'm gonna read, I just finished Plagueis last night, but is The Chronicles of Jean Froissart. Now it's not a church history, but it's it's a secular history from a time where the church was important, obviously. From the time, like in England, it starts out with the death of King Edward II, so the son of Edward the Longshanks. Mm-hmm. And of course, as you probably know, King Edward III is the one who starts the Hundred Years' War. And it goes all the way up to Richard II. So about the first two-thirds of the Hundred Years' War are covered in this, I don't know, is this medieval, late medieval, early?
Yeah, it'd have to be medieval.
Yeah, because that's a very important, like a lot of people don't know the importance of the Hundred Years' War. Like that's, like it completely changed all of Europe. And
and the 30 Years' War as well becomes sort of the war that ends up sort of putting a bad name to religion, which is interesting.
Yeah, no, that's true. That's like it ends with the Westphalia Treaty, right?
Peace of Westphalia.
I'm probably going to wait until January to read this, but are you familiar with the Sicilian Vespers?
No.
Okay, it's a primary source. A chronicle from the time, and it's kind of funny because in 1261, the Byzantines under Michael the VIII take back Constantinople. Now, it was not really supposed to happen like that. There was supposed to be a trade, but anyway, they take it back. And this pisses off a lot of bigwigs in the West. So the brother of King Louis the IX, Charles of Anjou, who's King Charles, is planning a crusade against Constantinople. It's like, I'm going to go take that city back. And he also owned Sicily because his empire was kind of like the successor of the Normans from the 11th century. So he owns Sicily. That's his like big part of his empire. And what Michael VIII does, who's the Byzantine Empire, he knows Charles of Anjou's plan, the crusade. He's not thinking of ideas. He's actually getting the troops together. So they're going to be here soon. So he sends a bunch of agents with a ton of gold to Sicily to bribe people to revolt against Charles of Anjou. And they managed to overthrow him. And so he no longer owns Sicily. His empire was destroyed. So he didn't have the resources to go on crusade. It's absolutely, it's one of my favorite parts of medieval history. Very clever.
Nice. Wow.
And Michael the Eighth, I don't like that guy, but that was clever. That was clever.
No. Yeah. No, yeah. I've finally got my place in Gallatin. And so I am sort of moving everything into that slowly. Unfortunately, there's some renovations happening in the place, so the landlord's taking care of it right now, and so I can't fully move everything in. But once I get everything moved in, I'll finally be able to have access to my books because they're all in storage right now. So,
In boxes in storage cells.
Yes.
Oh, interesting.
Yes.
Okay, so yeah, let's try to do another show like this in 6 months to a year. I need to read some more Star Wars books because we've talked about all the ones I read so far. Yeah, like I'm going to be reading Bane, Revan, and probably Kenobi, and maybe one more. Who knows? And
I forgot. Did you like Vector Prime or no?
I did. In fact, I bought the next two books. Darktide 1 and 2 because I was planning to continue, but you know, life got in the way, you know, things happened.
Yeah.
It's not like I made a decision not to read them. It just, I got caught up in other things. I didn't end up reading them. So, that's a plan. And those books, Vector Prime, Darktide 1 and 2, are some precious books because they're some of the books that don't have legends on them. Like I'm not as against buying with, but I'd prefer if it didn't have it. Let's be honest. Yeah. But those old books I got, no legends on them.
In fact, I actually have a 20th, is it 25th or 20th anniversary? I guess it would have to be 20th anniversary edition of Heir to the Empire. And when I bought it, I thought, oh, okay, it doesn't have a Legends moniker, so it's fine. But then a few years later, I realized that, like, I was looking at the timeline, and it said Legends timeline. And I said, what is this crap? Mm. So I literally looked on eBay or Etsy or whatever, I think at eBay, to find one that didn't have the Legends moniker, that it was published before Disney took over. And so I even had the seller take a picture to show that it didn't say Legends on it. And so when I confirmed that, I purchased that copy. That's how much I hate it.
Wow, that is dedication. You are,
and then I gave my I gave my copy that had Legends on it. I gave it to a friend of mine. I just gave it to him for free.
Oh, it's like, here you go. Here's your free book.
Yep.
You know.
Yep.
I mean, I personally don't mind it. I prefer if it was not there, but
yeah,
I'm like, yeah, not too big a deal. It's the same story, right? So.
It is, you know, as long as we all love Jesus, right?
Amen. All right. Are there any last words you want to talk about Plagueis or Heir to the Empire?
About Plagueis or Heir to the Empire? Let me think. Read Heir to the Empire. That is the first one that everyone who is new to Star Wars Expanded Universe, that's the first one everyone should read. The Plagueis is good, really good. I think I like a little bit better than Heir to the Empire, but the reason I always say Heir to the Empire should be read first is that it sort of sets everything. Like, everything sort of springs forth from Heir to the Empire, if that makes sense.
I think Plagueis you can actually read first because it's,
you can, yeah. Yeah,
it's fairly standalone, and it's kind of it's only connected to the prequels, and I kind of like how it's like a prequel to the prequels. Like it ties up some of the loose knots, like the 14-year-old. It explains even why Padme has her handmaidens who look like her. Like, it, that's even explained in there. But no, and it really does not focus on Anakin much, although it mentions him because he's
important. It explains even that. It explains him a bit.
Yeah, and like... And how Count Dooku left the Jedi Order. It ties up a lot of loose ends, and it's a great story. And for Heir to the Empire, it felt like it's kind of similar to this. This felt like a prequel of the prequels. That one felt like a continuation of the first trilogy. Because it's the same people. It's Luke, it's Leia, it's Han, it's Lando, it's Chewie. Like it's all them. Yeah, there's some new characters too, like Talon Card, Mara Jade, who actually worked for Talon Card. And Sabath and all that stuff, and it's a good. It starts to build the world that eventually the prequels are born into. So they're both great books: the Thrawn trilogy, Plagueis. Absolutely amazing. And I just hope that the next Star Wars books I read are at least in that ballpark. I don't think all of them are, but hopefully some of them are.
Yeah. No, I'll maybe once you get into the new Jedi Order stuff, I'll sort of help you navigate that, because some of them are not necessary, you know, but there are some that you absolutely have to read. Yeah.
Yeah. Like I think. Like there's Vector Prime. I think the next one is Balance Point, but there's some in between that you could read if you want.
Balance Point is an important one to read. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Like I meant the ones in between Balance Point and Vector Prime. Like those aren't as important. I don't know. I got a long way to get to the new Jedi Order though. That's a long way off even. Apparently I need to read the Hand of Thrawn duology. I need to read the Corellian trilogy. Apparently that's a must.
Yes.
And then there's probably some option ones like I don't know. Do I need to read X-Wing? I've heard good things about it though. So I mean,
yeah, you should read X-Wing. It's up to you, but and I'm not sure how well it will work, but. I've not read the Young Jedi Knight series since I was a preteen and slash teen. Maybe don't necessarily have to read them, but I think it's good to sort of go over the wiki pages of them or something like that. Just to sort of
Well, I'm just saying those books are actually hard to find.
I was able to find all of them. It was difficult, but I was able to find all of them within the past 2 years.
Really? So
it was not easy. Them then? Yes.
And for you, you had to make sure they don't have the old Legends bar on them.
Oh yeah, I don't think any of them do. Actually, that was the easy part because like they're not being remade or anything like that, as far as I know. Maybe they are, but I didn't see any.
Yeah. So in terms of like I'm going to read Bane, Revan, and Kenobi, and eventually, like as soon as I go. Post Thrawn, I'm going to read the Jedi Academy because this was the next ones that were written. I think this one is the one that has the Sun Crusher in it. Or
which one's that one? Of them. Jedi Academy. Yeah, that's the Sun Crusher one. Now that I'm thinking about it, yes. I'm 70% sure. Jedi. What is the name of the character who's
It's Kip Duran, right?
Kip Duran. There you go. Yeah. Let me see.
Yeah, I read the back.
Yeah, I think it is. Okay, I can't find. Jedi Academy Trilogy. Let me look if it says Sun Crusher. Yeah, I think that is the one. Yeah, okay. So that's... okay. Yeah, okay. That's what it was. Yeah, it's good. It should be read.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, like right now I'm going to the Old Republic with Bane. This is going to be fun. Bane and Revan. All right. Well, I think I will kill the stream now. This has been fun. And yeah, we will definitely do one in the next 6 months. If not 6 months, definitely a year. Because I you know, it'll take me a while to read these books. And most of the reading I do is still still nonfiction, right? Trying to grow my channel. Lots of history stuff coming up for those who are watching. And I'm tempted, I've got a few books to start. I'm tempted to research the colonization of America, of the Americas, because just a counter popular culture, just so much garbage out there, just lies.
Yes.
Like, oh, they saw them, they had different color skin, and then they killed them all because they're a bunch of disgusting races. That couldn't be further from the truth. I'm not saying that they didn't commit atrocities in certain cases, but I mean, to just paint it with this broad brush, just horrible, you know. Mm-hmm. All right, Father James, I'm going to kill the stream. God bless.
Let me say, wait, really quick before.
Oh,
I forgot. Okay. I'm wearing my Star Wars shirt. One of my many Star Wars shirts. It's Darth Vader, Boba Fett, and a stormtrooper in a band, a three-piece band. Sorry, I forgot to point that out.
A triumvirate, I guess.
Yes. All right, peace.
All right, peace.